So if you're asking about my own personal motivation, I must say that in school I was very fascinated by all kinds of experiments. And somehow I feel I should have gone into experimental science, but that didn't happen. So we used to have, these little sets where you could do a chemical experiment or a mechanical experiment, or you could just, there were people, inspiring people around who would explain things like how friction works, or very simple things, very basic things. And I found that if you can understand how something works, you feel satisfied. That was the basic drive. When I got to college, I must say that it's a very simple story. All my friends went into physics, and so I also went into physics. I don't think I applied any great brain power to that decision. And I think it's quite funny that today people spend a lot of time micro thinking through all their career decisions. In that time, we didn't bother, and we somehow just ended up somewhere.
So was it more like a peer pressure kind of thing?
I won't say it was peer pressure. I think I just, instinctively felt. So my friends in college certainly felt very deeply, and maybe more deeply than me, that physics is like an ultimate understanding of nature, and it's a science that's in some way the most beautiful. I won't say anything like most or not most beautiful today, but my friends certainly did think so, and I was taken along by their enthusiasm.
So you went with the flow?
I went with the flow, that is correct. Wow, that's quite an assignment. Okay, let me try. So let me start with the 8th standard student. So I would tell the student, can you be the student?
Sure.
So I'm telling you what string theory is. So in my field of study, we want to understand the different basic objects that make up everything in the universe and how these different objects interact. Already we understand quite well what are the objects and how they interact, but there are some missing pieces, and string theory is a proposal to fill in the missing pieces and have a better understanding of the basic objects and their interactions. Was it simple enough for an 8th standard student? I hope so. Okay. So for a 12th standard student, so I would I expect that you have heard about the existence of elementary particles, which are found when we break matter up into its smallest possible constituents. Now we also know that these elementary particles interact with each other by exchanging other particles. This is something maybe it's not taught in school, it's taught at college level. But the interaction between two elementary particles is by one of them giving off something and the other one catching it. And people give a model that imagine two people at the beach. I throw a ball, you catch the ball. So I have thrown the ball and gone back. You catch the ball and you go back. This is the way that I have exerted a force on you. This is a model, crude model, but that's the model we have of elementary particles and how they interact. Now the fact is that we have a lot of elementary particles and a lot of interactions, and string theory is an attempt to bring some kind of order, simplicity and generality to this picture. So the postgraduate student in physics might know that elementary particles are very well described by a theory called the standard model of particle physics, which is constantly being tested at accelerators and also in the universe outside. Every experiment we do at an accelerator or with objects like cosmic rays or objects outside our planet, in some way or other is testing the standard model. So it's a very well tested theory. And the theory has some puzzles in it, but by and large it works well. However, there's also a force called gravitation, which is not a part of this theory. And all our attempts to combine the standard model of particle physics with the theory of gravity as developed by Einstein have failed. And to date, it seems that the most compelling chance of combining these two is through a new kind of theory called string theory, in which we replace the elementary particles by small strings. So actually, there were two steps in a way. The first is very interesting that in the early 70s, two physicists, Nambu and Susskind, proposed that the force between two quarks, which are the particles that make up a proton, that force they tried to model by saying there's a kind of string between them. Now, this is not what today we would call string theory, because they were saying that, well, there are elementary particles, but they are somehow joined by a string of force. It was a kind of model, and the string behaves like a rubber band. That model was quite successful in describing the qualitative behavior of quarks when they are bound inside a proton. But when the model was studied in more depth, it turned out to have more features than were put into it. And one of those features was that in a very natural way, it reproduces a whole set of, the string itself reproduces a whole set of elementary particles, which qualitatively have some similarity with those that we see in nature. Not precisely, but in general have some similarities. So the breakthrough, the first breakthrough was to realize that string theory is potentially a theory not just of some interaction between quarks, but a description, a unified description of all forces in nature. This step didn't happen in one day. It took place slowly during the 1970s and early 80s. But the second step was what people call the string breakthrough or string revolution. And this was in 1984, when a very difficult mathematical calculation showed that the potentially inconsistent theories of strings were actually consistent. It actually showed that, you know, there was some risk that the theory might turn out to not have a coherent mathematical structure. But in 1984, in one particular paper, it was shown that in fact they survived this challenge and they are good mathematical theories. That's very important, because without correct mathematics, we can't have physics. We can't have theoretical physics.
So the credit for the development of this theory equally goes to the mathematicians and the physicists.
No, it was the mathematical work was done by physicists. I say mathematical in the sense that it was not a conceptual idea, it was rather a hard calculation. So when it's a hard calculation, we say, well, that's the mathematics part of it. But you're right, the credit is shared between different groups of physicists, one who did something very striking in 1984, but also others who did important things before that, and they had actually many conceptual ideas which still survive to this day.
So as far as I understand, that for string theory to be mathematically consistent requires extra dimensions. The strings vibrate in not just the dimensions we see, but in principle in extra dimensions. Why do you think that seeing the universe around us in multiple dimensions as strings vibrating makes it easier to understand?
No, so it definitely doesn't make it easier to understand. And again, this is a consequence of the mathematical consistency of the theory. Now, you can take it in two ways. You can say, well, we know that we live in three space and one time dimension, and therefore the total is four, and that's what we should have. But string theory seems to say otherwise. It says no, the underlying theory seems to be 10-dimensional. Now, this raises questions about space-time itself. Why is space-time 3-dimensional? And if you ask a good experimental physicist, they will tell you that we don't know space-time is 3 plus 1-dimensional. We don't know that space around us is 3-dimensional. We only know that if we use probes up to certain energy, then we can only detect 3 space dimensions, but it's always possible that there are additional hidden dimensions which are not accessible till you go to very high energy. Now, it's not obvious to a non-physicist, but to detect extra dimensions, you might need very high energy particles, and the energy is limited by whatever is available in your accelerator. So the possibility of extra dimensions has always been around, and it will always be around, because you need experiments to rule them out. Otherwise, it's a possibility. String theory seems to make use of the possibility. So people thought, good, let's take it as an advantage and build models which constructively use these extra dimensions to give us phenomena in our world which we actually see. So there's a relation between the extra dimensions and the forces that we observe in nature.
What is the dream of a string theorist, and do you prefer to be called that?
I prefer to be called a high energy theorist, My interest is in the phenomena of fundamental forces and interactions. If string theory isn't the right theory for that, I would be equally interested in any other which describes those phenomena.
So it's like a tool for you?
It's like a tool, absolutely. It is a tool, and it may be a correct one or useful one, or it may be not useful. I like to say that, you know, we don't necessarily think of theories as being correct or wrong, but as being useful or not useful. Well, the dream of not maybe all theoretical physicists, but at least me personally, is that we will find a candidate theory or model which describes the forces in nature which are covered by the standard model, and also the force of gravitation, which is the fourth and only remaining force in nature, all in one framework. That is a dream. And I personally believe that will be realized. It may take some time, but I see no obstacle to realize that. So the Large Hadron Collider is probing a certain range of energies, and it can only give us answers about that range of energies that it probes. But those answers might, if they are favorable, might point us or might support or might agree with or might fit with our understanding of nature through string theory. And some of those phenomena are, for example, the possible discovery of supersymmetry. Now, if this is a new symmetry, postulated symmetry, for which the Hadron Collider is actually searching actively. It's one of the purposes for which it was built. If they find evidence of that, it is not evidence of string theory, but I think it will make everyone who does string theory quite happy, because they'll say, okay, if it's realized in nature and since it is central in string theory, there might be some connection. So we are kind of groping for a connection. Similarly, if any evidence is found of an extra dimension, that also would support the idea of string theory. So these are indirect supports, but we don't hope for a direct verification of string theory at any terrestrial collider, not now and maybe not in the future also. Well, the payoff would certainly be finding the unified theory of all fundamental interactions. It's quite possible, some people are working on it, because this direction hasn't worked out in the short time that we expected it would. So in 1984, people were thinking that in 4 or 5 years, this whole story will be cleared up. It's nothing like that. It's been disappointing and it's been difficult. And so there are less people within the string theory community working on this unification direction than there were. But all it takes, I feel, is one person or one group who have a good understanding of what we know and are able to find a different direction to think along and maybe make some breakthrough. I can't, of course, say whether it will happen or not happen.
If I'm not wrong, you finished your PhD in 1981, right?
That's right.
So. And the big breakthrough came around in 1984.
That's correct.
So
actually, it came virtually on the day I joined Tata Institute of Fundamental Research as a postdoc.
Oh, interesting. So what hopes did you have as a graduate student when you decided to work upon the suspect of theoretical physics? Were there many other students along with you at that time who took up their research area to be string theory?
Actually, what I worked on was not string theory at the time. At least it was not known under that name. But it was some theoretical work which fitted with string theory later on in an unexpected way. So actually my PhD thesis had a very unexpected impact on string theory, but I had not even heard of string theory when I did that thesis. So, but as far as other students know, I think there was certain amount of negativity about these speculative directions even then, and there is even now, maybe more so now. I would say that I was attracted by the type of work, the actual mathematics and the calculations and the way it was conceived and the way it was done. I found it just very appealing and I found that I can do it. So sometimes, you know, there are many areas of physics which are very important, but I don't think I could do them. So, you know, it depends on one's taste.
Now how has it changed over the years, and now do you find it difficult or easier to have students who want to do research in this field?
Well, since the last couple of years, I can't take students anymore because I'll be actually superannuating or retiring in a couple of years. But over the 90s and 2000s, when I was in TIFR, I found there was a steady supply of students who were interested in string theory, and as far as I know, there is still such a steady supply. I would say that enthusiasm for this has not gone down nor gone up. But also it's true that string theory now covers many more questions than just unification of all forces. And so it offers many different theoretical ideas to many different physics problems.
After the 2019 Nobel Prize winners were announced this year, there was a blog on the popular science magazine Scientific American, written by science writer John Horgan, about a 2002 bet he won $4,000 with physicist Mikio Kaku that by 2020 no unified theory of physics will win a Nobel Prize. If you have to make a bet on the same argument but for say over the next 20 years, which side of the bet would you be on and why?
I think it's really silly to make bets, honestly. You know, I don't mind doing silly things, but I would say that making bets like this is sillier than the things that I do.
Apart from the research that you are involved in, we have heard a lot about your vast interest in music and cinema. We are most certainly interested in getting to know that side of yours as well today. We heard that you're part of a progressive heavy metal band in IISER Pune itself. How did that happen?
That's very funny. You know, I had an interest in rock music since I was 14 years old, and also interest in many other kinds of music, and in fact Hindustani classical music also. But in recent years, I found that rock music is one thing that really relaxes me when I'm stressed with other things. I found that it's because it's loud and because it's intense and because the lyrics somehow connect with one's own feelings, or my feelings maybe, I just started to like it more and more. And last year, two students who were doing projects with me, I found that they had a band and they didn't have a vocalist. So I said, can I try? And of course they said yes. And then I felt maybe I have forced them to say yes because they are my students. But anyway, they were kind and we tried, and it seemed to work. And I must say that I feel that they don't, when we are in the practice room, which we were even today evening before this, they are not my students anymore. In fact, I consider myself to be their students because they know a lot more about this field than I do.
I'm surprised that you don't play any string instrument in the band. Just kidding.
No, actually I do play. I've been learning guitar, and before that in my young days I learned to play sitar. So yeah, I can play string instruments.
So now I'm going to ask you a few quick questions about your interests other than physics. Who are your top three favorite jazz and top three Indian classical musicians?
Yeah, again, I'm tempted to say that lists are not really, don't make any sense, but let me try anyway. So in jazz, I have one favorite musician, that is Charles Mingus, who has always, for many decades, been my favorite jazz musician, composer, a bass player, and is now no more. He's always been my favorite. I can mention John Coltrane as another favorite jazz musician. Indian classical. So here I would like to first of all mention Ustad Vilayat Khan, the sitarist who really had an impact on me in my formative, in my school years. And I studied sitar actually from a student of his. And then of course Pandit Kumar Gandhar, who I have been obsessed with for the last maybe four decades. So these are two people I would name. Oh, that's very difficult. No, I can name you my 10 favorite or 5 favorite, but I can't name one favorite.
Five.
So one of the bands which I think excited me a lot in the 60s and 70s was Led Zeppelin. And I got a chance to see them live in New York, which was really one of the memorable experiences. In addition to that, I would say there's a progressive band called King Crimson, and we play a song of theirs. Our band did a song of theirs here in Karma last year, and I really like them. 21st century Schizoid Man, yes, we did that last year. You can actually find it on YouTube. Yeah. And another different direction is a band, a jazz rock band called Steely Dan, which is a very kind of intellectual, jazzy kind of band. And I really like their compositions, and we are even thinking of doing a song of theirs. So they are very different. These are like different directions in rock music. I'm not so well versed in modern heavy metal. This I have to learn from my colleagues in the band.
Interesting. How about Pink Floyd?
Oh, I love Pink Floyd. You know, that's why, you know, if I had to name 10, you would have got many more names, but I love Pink Floyd, and I never got to see them. But I did get to see Roger Waters in Bombay, and he did perform the whole Dark Side of the Moon.
That is actually my next question. What are some of the best music concerts you have attended and the concerts that you wanted to?
Wanted to are too many. Best music concerts, I can tell you happily. So I attended Led Zeppelin at Madison Square Garden. Then I attended the Rolling Stones concert in Bombay in 2003, I think.
In Bombay.
That was really, and not just in Bombay, but you know, I was 10 feet away from the stage. That was by far the best. I can't think of anything more exciting.
Mick Jagger
right there, just right there, as if he was in this room. All of them.
Mick Jagger.
Yeah, all of them were there. And it was a very good concert too. They didn't just come and do something, they actually performed really well. So that was one of the really all-time great concerts. I was telling my bandmates today that Pulp Fiction is my top movie. But of course, but you know, there's another side of cinema also. For example, I was very moved by the Bengali cinema of Satyajit Ray and Ritwik Ghatak and so on. And Pather Panchali I have seen many times, like maybe 6 or 7 times, and still it seems like a little piece of perfection, like in that world. So, you know, there's so many kinds of cinema and so many kinds of great movies.
You would rather like to mention the directors?
Yes, I definitely focus on the director. That's a fact. Yes. When I think about movies, I almost always think about the director. I wouldn't choose either. I like both. I have a lot of memories of both, but I don't like big cities anymore. I like Pune. In fact, if the traffic in Pune could be just a little better, I would like it more. But I like Pune very much. There it's actually quite clear, because on one side TIFR made my life, and TIFR is great and I love it when I go. But the moment I moved to IISER Pune, I became an IISERite, and I never felt like going back to being a TIFR person. That's just because it was a change in my direction of my life. I wanted to be in a place with undergraduates and to teach them and to guide them and interact with them. And I thought it's very important for India to engage with undergraduates, Indian scientists, to do that. I never thought I'd also have a rock band with people who are 1/3 of my age. That also happened. But in general, once I came to IISER, I had moved on, and then there was no question of going back as a TIFR person. But I go back very happily, and I love being there also. Oh, these are very difficult, because you know what I've read at a particular time influences me at that time. No, I think favorite books, I find it very hard to shortlist books. I would say that there are a few textbooks that really thrilled me. Actually, I must say that one of the textbooks I have a love affair with, though I never mastered it completely, is a book on topology and differential geometry by Singer and Thorpe. It's a mathematics textbook. I just read it from beginning to end and tried to work out everything about 3 decades ago. It's a very favorite book. But you know, there could be so many others. I mean, Musician, 100%. If you have the ability and interest, then go in for music. I don't know, that sounds too negative. Let me put it more in a more complex way. Try to do at least 2 things, which you both enjoy both of them. And actually, that advice I've taken for myself, so I'm fully satisfied that I do 2 things. And I would give that advice to anyone, because you know, one thing doesn't always support you. Like someday the physics will go badly. Other days I can't sing to save my life. So, you know, there's always, if you have two things, then one of them usually works on any given day and your life is more pleasant. It might be a musician. I might have, yes. I don't know if I can name a person. I think, yes, I think one of my big curiosities would be to, I can name two, three people if you don't mind. One is a class of people were the African-American or black musicians of United States who, out of their suffering and the oppression that they experienced, invented jazz, blues, rock and roll, three types of music which had never been heard before, by synthesizing all the music that they heard, including their own sort of memories, maybe in some indirect memories of their original homeland and lots of things. And I just don't know how that happened, but it was a development that just overtook the music world in an amazing way. The second type of people I'd like to talk to are not exactly musicians, but I would say the three big saint poets of our tradition, Surdas, well, three or four, Surdas, Tulsidas, Kabir, Mirabai. I would really like to know what motivated them to write such fabulous poetry, because to the extent I understand what they wrote, it's deep philosophy, deep sentiment, beautifully written, and it was written in a kind of song medium as poetry or as song. And I have no idea how they did it, so, or why they did it. Well, that's pretty easy. I was lucky to study in the same place as Ashok Sen, who is my peer, my same age as me, almost exactly within a few months. But he's a person of such superior intellect and such superior approach to science that from the day I met him, he has motivated me. So there's no two ways about that. Anybody who has met him has been motivated by him, but I was lucky to be with him firsthand. We were neighbors in the hostel in Stony Brook during our PhD. And I've always been motivated by the way he does things. Sometimes we collaborated during the late 1980s, we collaborated on a few papers. As far as Western scientist, Edward Witten has been my great hero. And there was a period when I remember he was writing so many papers that were inspiring me to write something of much lower level, but still in some kind of similar spirit and with the kind of ideas that he had put forward. So I would say Edward Witten has been a great inspiration of mine.
Talking about Dr. Ashok Sen, so you even shared the same advisor, right?
We shared the same advisor, that's correct. But again, as usual, you know, we interacted about the thesis work I was doing and he helped me out with various things. I had actually two advisors, so my second advisor was the same as his advisor.
So thank you very much, Dr. Mukhi, for being here with us on SciTalk at SMC. We definitely learned a lot of interesting stuff about string theory and you today. Thank you once again for your time, and we wish you all the best for your future endeavors.
Thank you.